Archbishop Dolan, the worldwide celebration of the year for priests will shortly come to an end. What do you think the year has meant for the church and for priests?
You know, Pope Benedict XVI is a great teacher. And like any teacher, he knows that you kind of need events and you kind of need themes and you kind of need to set a tone. And that's what he's trying to do in the church. You remember last year he did it very effectively with the year of St. Paul. And then I think throughout the Church Universal, people just enthusiastically welcomed his invitation that we would spend this current year as a year for priests. You ask what have been the fruits of that year? I think they've been rather abundant. In fact, I'm pleasantly surprised at the good things that I see coming from the year of priests. One that would be certainly kind of difficult to graph because the fruits would be by their nature more intangible would be the power of people's prayer for priests. I know, for instance, back home in the Archdiocese of New York, every parish that I go through, they've got this huge banner in the sanctuary asking people to pray with and for their priest. Now, one cannot exaggerate the importance and the wonderful spiritual fruits that would have come from that. And I myself am very touched to see the number of parishes that are having, special holy hours. I know in May there were quite a few of communal rosaries, all for the intentions of priests, to pray with and for the ones we got, to ask the Lord to give us even more, and to express a solidarity with priests in, let's face it, a rather critical time, a tough time for them as priests. So there's one, I think, very obvious fruit, the metrics of which we can't really graph because of their supernatural level. A second one, I think, has been, in a way, kind of allowing our priests almost to kind of stand a little taller, take a deep breath, and say, when all is said and done, our people still love us, the church still needs us, and the whole church seems to have rallied around us in a sign of very touching, tender affirmation. Now, we priests didn't ask for that. I don't think we expected that. We certainly don't think that is our due. And I don't even know if that was one of the intentions of Pope Benedict in proclaiming this year of priests. But I am pretty confident that indeed has been one of the fruits that priests will tell me how this has been sort of a booster shot for them, that here they see the people that they love at a time when very often all we hear about are the sins and scandals of priests. Here they just see their people rallying around them in a very touching sign of solidarity. And this has been amazingly effective for them. And thirdly, I think maybe what it's done is reconfirmed for the church what we've all known, but maybe which we needed to make explicit, and I think we have made it explicit during this year of priests, namely that the church needs her priests. There was, thanks be to God, and it was needed, and it was good, after the Second Vatican Council, there was a very laudable emphasis on all the other array of charisms and vocations in the church. And there was actually, in a very refreshing, necessary way, an affirmation that all of us, in a very real way, share in the common priesthood of Jesus Christ by baptism and by our sacramental life. Beautiful. Thanks be to God. We may have got that a little out of kilter, so that unintentionally priests thought, well, wow, I wonder what's unique. I wonder what's essential. I wonder what's still needed in my own priestly vocation in this atmosphere of emphasizing all the others, which they were for. And I think the year of priests has said to them, we need you. We love you. We appreciate and affirm the unique identity, charism, and vocation of the priest. In my mind, I think those are three benefits that have come from the year of priest.
A couple of years ago, you said that your mandate was to increase vocations, and you said that your policy was going to be happiness, that happiness attracts. And I'm just wondering, how have things been going in terms of vocations, numbers, and promotion?
At home, I just had the supreme privilege of ordaining 10 priests at St. Patrick's Cathedral for the Archdiocese of New York. I can't take credit for them. They were there when I got there. But I do believe, and I'm glad you mentioned, here I am at St. Patrick's College at Maynooth, this great seminary, where philosophy and theology are held in such high esteem. Our philosophers tell us, one of the first principles I ever learned when I was trying to study philosophy in preparation for priesthood, is that bonum diffusum est, good by its very nature expands. Good mushrooms. Good goes all over the place. So if I'm thinking to myself, if we can emphasize the good, if we can recapture the joy and happiness of priesthood, that's going to be explosive. That's going to get out there. Nobody wants to join a group of crabs. So if priests come across as crabby, as whiny, as unhappy, as persecuted, well, who in the world's going to buy a ticket on the Titanic, see? But if you got priests that are happy, a happiness that is especially noteworthy at a time when things might not be going particularly well for priests, boy, you're going to have a lot of young men and a lot of parents saying, hey, that must be a great way to spend one's life. And I think we're going to attract them. I love to quote the statistic at home, and I don't know if it's true in Ireland or not, and I don't know if there were two, in the last 2 or 3 years, there were two scholarly research projects done on the happiness of priests. Because the word is out there, the priests aren't happy, see, that morale is bad. Well, one was done by Dean Hoag, who is a renowned sociologist. The other was done by the Los Angeles Times. Now, neither of these would be particularly ardently pro-Catholic. They're not looking for good news. But both of them expressed great consternation that they found that priests were the happiest of any profession that they studied. That 94% of priests in the United States said, if I had to do it all over again, I'd still be a priest. And expressed a higher sense of joy and satisfaction in their vocation than doctors, than policemen, than firemen, than healthcare workers, you name it, all right? Now that's astounding, and what I'm thanks be to God for that, but that's not the impression given, is it, Brenda? And what I'm always saying to priests is, don't be afraid to exude that joy. I wonder sometimes, you know, it's a chilling fact today, I hate to say it, you know, of what, when I interview a young man who's going to come to our seminary in New York, St. Joseph's Seminary at Dunwoody. Wow, more often than not, the fellow will say to me, you know, my folks aren't all that happy about the vocation. I understand that's also even more the case for a young woman who might say, I'm very interested in consecrated religious life. And I sometimes wonder, right away I'm thinking, wow, those parents must not have any faith, or those parents must be turned off by the church. They don't want their son or daughter to think about a vocation as a priest or a nun. But you know what? I wonder if parents naturally, they just want their kids to be happy, right? In a way, they could care less what their kids are doing. They could care less if their kids are collecting garbage, or if their kids want to be an astronaut, as long as it's going to make them happy. They're worried that if their son or daughter says, I want to be a priest or I want to be a sister, he or she's not going to be happy. Well, and you can't blame them sometimes, because maybe all they see is grim, glum priests and sisters and brothers. That's not what I see. I see priests who are bristling with excitement and who are alive and happy. But we probably got to do a better job of getting that across. And I think that's going to be a magnet for vocations if we do.
You spoke recently about the importance of putting Sunday Mass first. But for many Catholics, Sunday Mass is not a part of the routine. What can the church do about that? And why is it so important for Catholics to attend Sunday Mass?
I have been accused of being a bit naive, maybe overly simplistic. Recently, I've expanded it. I've said, look, here's two things I want us to concentrate on. We're always talking about all these highfalutin goals in the church. And I said, here's two things I want us to concentrate on. Sunday Mass and the morning offering. Now, people might snicker and say, of all the problems we got in the church today, those are the two things you're trying to emphasize. If we take Jesus seriously, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and everything else will come in its place. Well, let's seek ye first. on the first day of the week with the greatest prayer that we got, the Sunday Mass, and every morning when we get out of bed and consecrating the day for His honor and glory in the morning offering. If we do that, great things are going to happen. I also wonder if we know, we just got some great statistics in the United States. Pardon me for, you know, in America, we're all big into these studies and these polls and everything. We just got some great statistics. In one way, they're grim statistics, but they show us a great thing from a place called the Pew Center. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's kind of a prestigious national research organization located in Philadelphia. And they did a study on religion in America. Now, bad news, sobering news. Only about 1/3 of Catholics in the United States go to Sunday Mass. Compared to some countries, you know, they say, hey, pop the champagne cork. That's better than we got. But compared to what we had four decades ago, this is bad, all right? That's bad news. Good news is the verification of the magnificent fruits that come from those who go to Sunday Mass. So get this, the Pew Center tells us that those who are faithful to Sunday Mass, even though they might be fewer, those who are faithful to Sunday Mass have happier lives, have more faithful marriages, have more united families, have better health, are more active in community affairs, are better versed in their faith and able to present it and defend it, pray better, more effectively pass the faith on to their children, give more to the church, and are much more likely to consider a vocation to the priesthood or religious life. We often say today, hey, there's no silver bullet to all the problems that we got in the church. I think we do. I think there is. If we're able to get our people back to Sunday Mass, look what's going to happen, see? Now, I don't have the answers how to do that. I'm kind of thinking, at least as Archbishop of New York, at least I ought to be pretty blunt about the problem and let people know the challenge that we got and at least the benefits of attending Sunday Mass and to constantly harp on that, not to nag, that's always counterproductive, but at least to be indefatigable in preaching that message. Some folks have said, why are you talking about the decline in Sunday Mass all the time? That's bad news, and maybe you're going to discourage people. And I think, well, look, the news is out there anyway. They know it. Anybody with a half a brain looks around and says, wow, there's not as many here that used to be. Any grandparent or parent is always saying to me, I'm really worried my kids don't go to Sunday Mass. So it's not like I'm telling them something they don't know. But if we're blunt and realistic about it, and if we got a pastoral strategy to try to do something about it, I think we're back on the right track of we put God first. You don't know the miracles that can happen. We do that through Sunday Mass.
Archbishop, you're very active in terms of blogging and social networking. And Pope Benedict, in his message for World Communications this year, used as the theme, the priest and pastoral ministry in a digital world, new media at the service of the word. Does iMinistry or online ministry have a significant role to play in the spreading of the gospel message?
Yes. Now, Brenda, I'm going to tell you something, and I can't leave this room, okay? I don't know the first thing about technology. I still use a fountain pen. But here's what I'm getting at, Brenda. I highly appreciate the effectiveness of it. So when I got, actually in Milwaukee, and when I got to New York, especially New York, which is the communications capital of the world, I said to my people, and thank God I got a great staff, I said, look, I want you to drive me crazy with every possible means of communication that we've got out there. I don't even know how to spell half of them. All right, I'm finally learning how to send a fax, okay? But I don't have to know how to do them, because thanks be to God, I got you. But I want to be on all of this. And I'm told this, Brenda, we got to start asking good questions. You know, we have to say, look, I know you guys got a good Catholic press here in Ireland. We got a good one in America. We have a fine archdiocesan newspaper in the Archdiocese of New York. But I'm told that if you do stats here, the average reader in our weekly newspaper is 68. Well, we're not getting the most of the people. Just like 60 years ago, it was daring to say, we got to get in the newspapers. Just like 60 years ago, it was daring to say we got to get into radio. Just like 50 years ago, it was daring to say the church has to be on TV. Just like 25 years ago, it was daring that the church says we got to set up communications people like you're doing right now. So we got to say, now we roll with the punches. So now we got to get on all this digital stuff, all this technological stuff, all this, what'd you call it, eye communication or whatever? We got to get into that. So I say to them, you tell me what I need to do, and I'll do it. So I don't want to bust any balloons here, but I don't sit down and blog my piece every other week. I do write it, and then it's put on the blog, and I'm constantly thinking about it. And there might be every 2 or 3 days, like I'm saying, usually I try every week I try to put something out, either my column in the newspaper, which comes out every other week, or a blog piece. The beauty of the blog is you can do ad hoc stuff. So if I'm looking in the paper in the morning and I'm saying, this needs an answer, or this needs some commentary, or this needs to be put into perspective, we got the blog to do it. And I'm told that's more effective sometimes than you know, if I waited for a week to put up my next newspaper column. So you got to do it.